It's November 2nd. Welcome, everyone, to the Hadley Public Schools School Committee. We haven't met for 15 years, or 4 weeks.
Feels that way.
Let's see, approval of minutes of, oh, October 1st was the last time we met.
Yeah, a month ago.
Anyone read the minutes, have anything to say about them?
No comment.
They were brief.
It was a brief meeting.
It was good.
Like our meeting.
Yes. Want to make a motion?
A motion to
Thank you.
Approve the minutes of October 1st, 2015.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Adjustments to the agenda. We are putting off presentation 4B until November, and we are replacing that with the discussion about creating a gift account. Yes. Anything else?
Nope.
Okie doke. So here we go. Senora.
So first up, Senora. Actually,
I'm here tonight, hopefully making a request to start the process of a trip to Nicaragua, a service trip to Nicaragua with the students. I brought this idea up last year. We had a young man come talk to us about his business. He was formerly a teacher at Smith Academy, and he created a business called Amped for Education, and it's a phenomenal business. And primarily what they do is take high school students over to do service in the country, and then there are a couple different excursions they get part of, they are part of as well. So I'm hoping that we can do this. There we have a short video that talks about a trip that Frontier took.
So Frontier Regional High School has done this, and we've spoken with their superintendent, and Senora has also spoken with the teacher, and Hatfield was the other school that has done this.
Yes.
And the teacher to whom you referred, I think, is now teaching here.
Yes, Jeff Pluta is the one he's the founder of Amped for Education, and he actually just got a job in South Hadley, and I think it's a temporary position, but he's the founder of this company.
So this is an overview of Amped for Education, their promo video that features Frontier Regional High School students on their trip.
Started and for education, we were focused on bringing education and creating educational opportunities for Nicaraguan students. But we found that the effect that these experiences and these trips have on the American students that join us is as profound as it is for some of the Nicaraguan kids.
Interesting to see the perspectives that you get from each different group. So, you know, I've been here with two high school groups, and it's interesting to see how they view Nicaragua, and I've been here with people who this is the first country outside of the U.S. they've been to.
I feel like we're making a huge impact here. I mean, the kids who go to this primary school, we're having to take classes at the high school.
It was not what I expected at all. It was just beautiful here. The culture is amazing. I just love it down here.
Obviously, as a teacher, I value education. That being said, education is something that's almost timeless, and it's something that is going to pay dividends now, later, and for the rest of your life. And so how I like to think about it is to think about a student's life with an education starting from age 5, and then think about that same human being without an education from that same age, and where are they when they're 18?
I came to Nicaragua last year, and I came back because it was so different from anything I've ever done before. I really loved it here. I'd never been out of the United States, and I had a really great time. I love being in Nicaragua, besides just the volunteer work, which is actually really fun. I love all the excursions we go on. While we're working in Granada, we get to go to Lake Nicaragua, which is really great. We get to swim and go on a boat with kids from the school, which is really fun.
Advice somebody on doing this, I'd definitely say go for it, because once you get down here and realize what you're doing, like, that's just, it's such a great feeling.
We focus on working in the community, you know, 3/4 of the time, and then the last quarter of the trip is spent kind of relaxing out on the beach. and checking out some of the different parts of the country that you know, average people that come down and just solely work for 100% of the time don't get to see.
As a high school teacher, this is probably the most important teaching I've ever done. Being able to bring my students outside of the classroom to another country emphasizes all of the things that I've taught all semester. It's an amazing culminating activity. For teachers that are considering a trip like this, I would say that the manual labor aspect of this trip is important, but it's actually one of the smallest parts of the trip. There's so much bonding that goes on in other places, like at meals. The conversations that you have walking through the market or on the way to the job site or at dinner at night when you're recapping the day are extremely rewarding.
The sky's the limit for Amp for Education, and we're really excited about our future.
Questions? Cool.
That's yes. Awesome. So this trip would take place when?
We're hoping to actually do it February of 2017, next year.
Great.
And I would love to do a lot of fundraising because my goal would be to make it affordable for anybody who would like to go on the trip. Mm-hmm. So that's my hope.
And you mentioned you're interested in taking your own.
I would like, yes, actually I fundraise all the way through for my little guys to come with me, so. Because he said that's happened in the past too, and there's plenty of activities for them to get involved in with the people, and you know, the young kids in the community too.
So February 2017, and it would be eligible for kids in what grade?
I would like to say all high school students, because according to what I've heard from the founder, and he came and did several presentations here last year. He has had from all ages, high school through college, but all ages of high school kids.
And Ruthann, is there an average price per student?
He said that what they do is about $1,300 starts without the airfare, but he said he would think that if we said about $2,100 per student, that would be what he would imagine right now. But they actually, they make it work for us. They make it work. They come up with itinerary based on what we want to do while we're there, too.
And how long is the trip?
7 to 10 days. And that's been an average, too.
Yeah.
And what areas of the curriculum do you see this really strongly reinforcing?
Well, for sure, Spanish. I mean, that's my curriculum, of course. But, you know, I think you can get something in a service trip. I think you can get something throughout all curriculums, really. I think, you know, you learn a lot about people from different countries. I think there are many, many places that they could grow, really. And I think we haven't done this kind of thing in Hadley, and I've been yearning for it. I did it a lot as a youngster myself, so I'm yearning to have this happen for my students. And I know we have the interest.
And last year there, we had visitors come from Guatemala that made some very explicit connections between art and foreign language.
Yes.
And
right.
So I know art and foreign language were connected. And there were some joint projects that continued, and you continued some of the connections with those students in Guatemala.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And I imagine just if it is still sort of building, building schools, then there's a lot of pre-engineering skills that
oh, sure.
you could imagine there.
Mm-hmm. What do you need from us besides a thumbs up?
I think we're looking for the thumbs up because I'd like to start fundraising instantly.
Yes, seconded.
How are you thinking about fundraising right then?
Well, I'm giving it a lot of thought because if it's going to cost $2,100 per person, like I said, I don't want anyone to feel left out. So, I mean, I've thought of a lot of different things along the way. One of the things that I thought about actually was I noticed this is just in my brain, so I don't know if it's going to go anywhere, but I noticed something that the Delaney House does. They have a night that you can go and you pay X amount of dollars, and they donate money to the newest thing is the Holyoke Boys and Girls Club. Mm-hmm. So I think that I would like to reach out so we can make big dollars quickly. That's my hope, you know, I so that everybody can go. That's really what it's all about for me.
Are there limits to the trip size?
I don't think so. That's what's funny. My students today, that when I talked to them about it, they asked the same question. I don't think that they've ever been dealt a group of people that they couldn't handle. As a matter of fact, they have built a house there that is just for the volunteers, so we would all be living together in the same under the same roof. And the kids would be, we would always, they would never be unattended, which is, I think, important too in the third world country. Mm-hmm. So I think it's a very safe opportunity.
I'm sure they welcome many people. It looks like there was plenty of work to be done.
Yeah.
So it's like there's a lot of hard work for the kids.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Ruth. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
I didn't catch the first and second or any of all that.
Oh, did you do that?
We did.
We gave all thumbs up.
Would you like it as a formal vote?
Sure. I could put thumbs up in the minutes, whatever you prefer.
Move to endorse the trip to Nicaragua presented today.
Yeah, second it.
All right.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
It'd be great, given how far away the trip is, to hear about it again at a future meeting once, you know, more information or concrete, you know, fundraising opportunities. It would
sure.
be great to hear back about that.
All right.
Great.
Okay. And next, I'm really grateful that Angie is going to be speaking to us and Brian and I all together about some of our outcomes in our school counseling program, particularly as they relate to secondary outcomes. This was actually a request from a school committee member who couldn't be here tonight. We put it off a couple times, and I didn't want the staff to keep waiting. She'll certainly get all the information. So we are going to do this together.
Let's talk about
it. You're beeping.
Join effort.
Join effort, yes. All right. And all right.
So thank you for inviting me. I'm the school counselor here at Hopkins, the one and only. And this is my third year. I started September 16th, 2013. I know the date, it was a Monday. And so it's been great. It's been challenging at times, but it's been well worth it. So one of the things that I've developed was a mission statement for the school counseling program here at Hopkins, because there wasn't one. And it's up on the screen if you want to take a look at it. But basically what it encompasses is the whole student as an individual, and supporting their academics. Their lifelong learning is really important for students these days. Education goes in so many directions now. It's very fluid than ever before. Students learn in so many different ways. And being able to support our students to really kind of create a sound body, sound mind, and to be able to be really successful when they move on and graduate from Hopkins.
The Massachusetts School Counselors Association and the National Association for School Counselors actually has standards and curricula and benchmarks. So I say this is not the guidance department that I remember in high school. So in other words, it's not just a place where I go and pick my classes, but that there's an entire curriculum. And Angie takes very seriously her role in supporting the academic curriculum frameworks. Guidance counselors are in classrooms now. They're not just sitting in their office waiting for individual appointments to show up, and their sole role isn't just talking about college. Let's go here. So another very short 2-minute Vizio, because
yep.
this is something that
so
you all introduced,
yep.
right?
So we have Naviance here, which is fabulous. A lot of schools, like the private schools, the Deerfield Academies, the Williston's, all have Naviance, and we're lucky enough to have it here. I introduced it last year to the 9th through 12th grade. This year, 7th and 8th grade are going to start that curricula, starting on Monday when I go into Mr. Breland's class, which is going to be really awesome.
And the Board of Trustees supports this,
which is great. So we'll go ahead and play it, and then I'll talk a little more in a minute.
A lot of students today have questions
about their futures. Some don't know what they're going to do with their lives, while others may know but have no idea how to get there. The problem is, students don't always get the personalized attention and guidance they need, so they don't see a link between what they're doing in the classroom and what they hope to do in the future. Families often want to help, but don't know how they can get involved, and school counselors are spending way too much time on paperwork just trying to keep track of all their students, which makes it impossible for them to prepare individual plans for each one. And although many school and district administrators see a problem, they lack the information needed to improve college and career readiness at their schools. What if schools could put each student on a personalized path to future success, and school counselors and administrators could provide expert guidance to students about college and career decisions? Well, that's the story behind Naviance. It's a comprehensive college and career readiness solution that empowers students and families to connect learning and life and provides schools and districts with the information they need to help students prepare for life after high school. Naviance allows students to create a plan for their futures by helping them discover their individual strengths and learning styles and explore career options based on their results. Then it gives the students tools to search for college programs based on their interests, determine which courses they need to take to reach their goals, and identify areas for improvement. Once students are ready, Naviance makes it easy for them to apply to colleges, look for scholarships, and track their admission status. It even allows families to track their students' progress and communicate with school counselors. But that's just part of the story. Naviance also makes student success planning easy for schools and districts by offering quick access to student data and goals, automation of routine tasks such as email communications, student surveys, and submission of college application materials, and the tools to measure the effectiveness of their school's college and career preparation. Schools and districts can identify which students need the most help and put them on the right path for success. Plus, track outcomes for all their students to see how many get into college, where they go to college, and whether or not they graduate. The end result is that schools and districts are better equipped to make informed decisions and prepare students for college and their futures. And students will have a better understanding of what they want to be and how they'll get there. Learn more at Naviance.com.
This is over for you.
She talks faster than me.
And she's super excited about
she's very
it, too.
Excited about it. So, one of the things that's great about the faculty here specifically is collaborating with them, specifically the English department, the social studies department. So last year, I went into all of the 10th grade U.S. history classes and did a whole curriculum on this, and the kids loved it. We started with watching The Secret Life of Walter Mitty and discussing what our passions are and what we really love. And it was such a great experience for the kids. Then we came back into the classroom. We had big discussion groups. We introduced Naviance. They did a couple of assessments on there, and they can go back and look at what their strengths are, what they really like. It kind of pinpoints their specific, not only their strengths, but what they truly love to do. Mm-hmm. So I think a lot of times in public education and in education, we kind of just jam curriculum down students without them saying, wait a second, I do love to canoe and I love being outside, and allowing them a space where they can explore that. So that's kind of what the focus was last year. I hope to do it again in all the classes. Another one we're hoping to do is Road Trip Nation. It was a series on PBS, where it follows students who are in college that are kind of lost and don't know exactly where to go. So that's going to be a new curriculum that's going to be introduced into grade 11, because I notice a lot with students in 11th grade, they have the pressure of colleges coming up. My parents really want me to apply to these colleges. I don't know what I want to major in. So it's just all these questions students have, and kind of just exploring their likes and where they want to go.
And when you say curriculum, that's its own class, part of a class? How does that work?
So with Mr. Burns, he just let me in and let me do what I wanted to do. But for this year, for example, April Camuso and I are developing a curriculum on resume writing. One of the things that I think students lack, and she seemed to agree, is how to write a resume, how to put one together, both for college and also for jobs. So because of her benchmarks and what she has to reach in the English department, I can also collaborate. So that would be called Mass Core, kind of combining the guidance curriculum with the English curriculum, and that would be under the Mass Core curriculum and what's required for English teachers and guidance counselors and so forth.
And so one of the things that you'll see you can see it intermittently in the calendar, but for each grade level, there's a set of protocols, more or less, that you want to follow in terms of piquing student interests. Yep.
Yeah, so you guys have a handout in front of you. It's a goldenrod handout, and it's an example of the guidance.
So piquing student interest at a cognitively appropriate level. And obviously in the 7th and 8th grade, students are still in the process of exploring and get a lot more field-based experiences across grade levels with things like Nature's Classroom and some of the hands-on field trips where they actually gather and manipulate data in the field. For us, Naviance and the integration of the guidance curriculum on an intermittent basis requires a couple of things. One, we need to be able to find a way to make sure we can hit every kid. So it requires that Angie work collaboratively with a group of teachers to make sure all of the kids get the same type of guidance curriculum in a classroom setting, so that it makes it more valuable when they go to the meeting, the individual meeting with her, when they're actually at the point of planning. So it's kind of funneling down that thinking into that meeting and still counseling them to understand that, you know, you might select to do this, but you certainly can understand kids transfer around colleges and change majors all the time too. So this isn't locking you into something for the rest of your life. But more than that, one meeting at the end of your junior year to sign up for SATs like it was when we were in high school, and then one in your senior year to get all your applications out. Students feel a lot more comfortable with the process when they get exposed to it over a period of time.
Mm-hmm. So just to add, school counselors are educators as well. So they educate students. They are teachers too, you know. So
yeah, I actually did, for the first time in my career, an observation report on a guidance counselor last year. Mm-hmm. So.
Want me to go ahead?
Yeah.
So
college visits, really quick. This year we have over 30 colleges coming in to visit Hopkins, which is a lot of schools for such a small school. And on the new website I created this year, which is still a work in progress, if you scroll down a little bit, there is the college representative visits. So students know and families know when colleges are coming in, what time they're coming in. Students can sign up, students can email me, students can see me in the morning to make sure they get a pass. I've had several parents call me this year saying, make sure my kid sees Curry College. I know we will. So it's really nice that they get that individualized attention. And here's our October calendar, which was pretty full too. So we have double booked schools, and teachers have been great because, you know, students will be missing a little bit of their academics at that time. So students have taken more responsibility saying, I really want to see Dean College. And teachers are like, you know, I understand how important it is, please go. And then, so it's great that these colleges come here and see us. So the dual enrollment program we have here is we're seniors right now can go and take courses at GCC, HCC, STIC, and UMass Amherst. Actually, I have students at all those schools right now. I have two students in particular that are doing their senior year at a community college. One of the great things about the Mass Transfer program is students earn, you know, go to community college or go to UMass Amherst and can immediately transfer into a four-year college or university after 2 years with a 3.0 average. The students that are there now are loving that experience. And the cost, the family do have to pay the cost of the tuition. However, the UMass, I have one student going to UMass who just happened to fall under a grant because she wanted to take Japanese. And so her course is free.
So who are these students? Of their own self-initiative, they've decided to seek
so
it out?
With the Naviance stuff and going into the classroom, I'm able to educate students about this opportunity. Mm-hmm. So I'm able to go into the classroom and say, what's a four-year college? What's a two-year college? What's the Mass Transfer program? And then we have a discussion as a class. And so it's open to anybody and anybody who might be interested. STIC, for example, offers College Now, so they do offer a free course for high school students each semester. I forgot to mention that. So no, I make sure that all students are aware of it their junior year.
Do students come to you? I'm sorry, do they come to you or are they recommended by faculty?
They come to me. So what's interesting too is just because a student is not at the top of their class, for example, doesn't mean they can't be successful in a community college as a senior. And I have found that I have all different types of students, and in my previous job at my old school, I was there for 10 years, and I had all different types of students take advantage of the dual enrollment program with huge success. I don't think I had one student fail or flunk out. All these schools are very accommodating to students with disabilities or students who have learning issues. I have been able to submit information to their professors if they have a 504, if they have suffered a concussion, so I'm able to be in contact with those people at those community colleges.
And at the same time, we've been able, Angie's worked really hard, in particular with GCC and now more recently with HCC, to enable us to do simultaneous dual enrollment so that students can expand the number of credits they take. They can sort of shrink their schedule of courses here at Hopkins and take those additional credits at the community college level that might be courses that, despite the fact that they're college courses, are, you know, more challenging, but they're in areas that the students are interested in studying later on down the road, or chipping away at a 101 level course while they're still in high school, so that their freshman year will be that much more interesting.
Mm-hmm. You know, what's also great too is because the cost of college is becoming so expensive that if a student's able to do a dual enrollment program and get their first year covered, it's pretty cheap. The tuition at UMass right now is $1,790, but fees and tuition are $14,000. So if students have this opportunity, this isn't for every student. I do have a lot of students who are like, no way, I'm staying here, I want to take AP courses, I want to be with my friends, and that is perfectly fine and that's great. But then there's the other students that really kind of want to get out and explore and see what's out there for them. One more thing I wanted to say about the Greenfield Community College, I've been in contact with them recently and they're hoping to offer 3 free courses to high school students. I tried to get them to come here, but they're actually going to be at Amherst and in Florence. So I'm going to make sure that information gets out to families and students so they can take advantage of the free college courses that GCC is going to offer in the spring.
Do you see this expanding?
Yes and no. I think here at Hopkins we have very traditional students who want that four-year college experience and don't necessarily want to go to GCC, HCC, and transfer into UMass. However, for the private schools like Cole, for example, I know that he is at American. So this may not be quite the way he might want to go just because American might not take those courses. Mm-hmm. So one of the things I tell students is when they go visit a college, if they're in, you know, they should ask that question when they're at the tour. Do you give credit for college courses at community colleges? How do admissions people look at that? Some are great, they love it, they think it's fabulous. Other schools are like, well, we won't give you credit for that because we want you to take our course. So.
But having the online options and the simultaneous enrollment opportunities gives us flexibility to at least open it up to students, which for a small school like us is a huge benefit because, you know, we can provide courses through our connections with the local colleges as though, and those students remain full-time students here. They just take one course at the community college per semester. So it's worked out
they
well.
They get their foot wet in the higher ed.
All right, so I'm going to talk a little bit about our post-secondary enrollment trend data. This is really fantastic. And you'll see percentages that compare our AP enrollments, our post-secondary enrollment, and our mass core completion to state averages. And no surprise, Hopkins does well. I don't believe these are data that the school committee has looked at previously. It is data that we can present to you annually so you can see over time. It's important not only to evaluate how you're doing in terms of student achievement. Next month, you'll hear about the achievement of our English language learners. Obviously, we look in depth at MCAS, and I provide you with formative and benchmark assessment data in various places, but it's important to see what's happening in terms of post-secondary outcomes. This graph, you can see the gray shows you your total graduating class and the number of those students who are enrolled in post-secondary institutions. That's private, two-year, four-year, or public. So the percentage, and you're looking, the gray is Hopkins Academy, the percentage of seniors who enrolled in post-secondary institutions, and the green is the state. So you can see, and particularly in 2013 and 14, and 2012, we started really vastly outperforming the state average, sorry Chris, and then you see that in 2013 and 2014. The reason I showed you those numbers on the first slide, so you can see that a 5% change is typically around 2 students because you have graduating classes of 40 students. Mm-hmm. So sometimes percentages can be a wee bit misleading with a small group of kids. That's why I showed you those numbers. But still, it's great to see. On the flip side of that, if a student or a couple of students don't pursue post-secondary education, then it certainly affects our percentages, and we still, again, vastly outperform the state. Mass core completion. Mass core, so I don't mess up the requirements. Mr. Beck is going to help me on mass core.
It's a set of courses that students are required to take in Massachusetts. in order to graduate effectively from high school, that includes 4 years of math, 4 years of English, at least 3 years of a lab science, at least 3 years of social studies, physical education, health. World language is not part of the mass core, is it?
I think it is too.
I think two years
of a world language as part of the mass core, and then there are 6 other credits and electives over the 4 years that build that requirement. So this is also a minimum number of credits required. And this went into place, if I'm not mistaken, 9 years ago, and we're required to report students that do or do not meet that requirement. And mm-hmm. part of the idea was to elevate those schools that did not have more rigorous graduation requirements for their students. For example, for a long time, there were many schools in Massachusetts that had only 3-year graduation, 3-year math or English graduation requirements. So
this is actually an option?
So
mass core is an option?
To get a high school diploma, no.
Yeah, there are very few students. So in Hadley, for students who might not meet the mass core, it might be a student who has needs, and might be on a plan, and they're able to attain the competency determination from the state, and they're able to meet our local graduation requirements through their modified coursework, but they haven't met the mass core.
I see. Mm-hmm.
So, and we have an obligation to report that.
Right.
And so again, you see, the light green is the percentage of students statewide, and the darker green is the percentage of students at Hawkins Academy. Mm-hmm. And in 12 and 14, we saw 100% of our students completing mass core requirements. This graph is all Hawkins students by year. The light green are the percentage of grads who completed, didn't just enroll, but actually completed one AP advanced placement course. The blue are the percentage of students who completed 2 or more advanced placement courses successfully, so they passed those courses. Again, our numbers are very strong, and it's demonstrated when you compare. So if you added the bars previously together, this is total Hopkins Academy percentage of students who completed at least successfully one AP course compared to statewide. So where 60% of our students complete at least one, if not more, and you saw a vast majority complete 2 or more, only 40% statewide. And in 2011, we were actually below the state, or neck and neck with the state. And you can see now, and I know this is very important to Mr. Beck, we have far outpaced the state in enrollment and successful completion of advanced placement courses, which is one of the things that when, is it U.S. News and World Report that gives out the high school award for, and what they look at is access and enrollment in advanced placement courses. That's really important to them.
And that's, you know, another reason in going through this year's counseling process that it was great that Angie had done some coursework and a great deal of research at the collegiate level and having access to a variety of admissions office along with the research that was done by the Massachusetts Math and Science Initiative. We provided students with access to that research while simultaneously working. Our faculty did a great deal of work to remove the barriers to entry into advanced placement courses so that there were no more prerequisite grades. I mean, if students wanted to challenge themselves with an advanced course, they're now able to do that. And what we've seen is an expansion in advanced placement enrollment this year, which also includes the opening of an AP course in the sophomore year in history, which is fantastic for our students because it gives them an opportunity to build a more rigorous transcript that's going to make them more competitive for college. Mm-hmm.
So these are really good data. We often talk in general terms about Hopkins being an excellent, highly competitive, but an excellent school that prepares students well for post-secondary options. And certainly, that's not just anecdotal. The data support that Hopkins far outperforms the state averages in terms of enrollment in advanced courses, placement and enrollment at post-secondary institutions, and completion of the mass core. And finally,
so just some future goals, just looking ahead. I've been working collaboratively with UMass and the school counseling program there. John Ramos was my intern last year. He's fabulous. And this year I have Andrew Goolsby Cole, who's also fabulous. So continuing partnering with them, it'd be great if they could also come in and do some research eventually. But it's a great program. And both Kat and Rich have been in the school, and they think it's a fabulous school, and it's really working out well. I'd love to do an introduction course, or at least an introduction lesson with the 5th and 6th grade. I think it's really important to get into the elementary school. I know there's no school counselor there. So kind of wedging my way over to the elementary school and introducing myself to the students. to the faculty, and I do know some of them, but just giving them kind of a glimpse of what's to come. Financial aid and college financing seminars for Hadley Elementary School. So I just had my financial aid night here last Thursday, and I know in the past families have always said, oh my gosh, this would be such great information if this was available to us in elementary schools.
When my child was born.
That's great.
Yeah. Exiting the hospital, perhaps a plan.
Because you know, they all walked out a little stressed, but I thought that was a great idea, so I'm thinking that would be really kind of neat to have MIFA come into the elementary schools and do a whole kind of seminar for elementary school families. My community mentor program for Hopkins Academy students, that's kind of my newest thing right now. Kind of getting, having students go out and kind of explore people and who they might want to mentor with. It's not necessarily a job shadow or a work study, but finding that cool adult that you can really connect with, I think that's really important for kids and teenagers and students to be able to find that in their community. I visualize a school counseling course for all Hopkins Academy students. I'd love to be in the classroom more and actually teach and kind of go over the social, emotional piece, the college career piece, and the academic piece with everybody in the classroom, and also including Naviance for all students and families in the district.
So Angie, in here in your mission statement, which I like, you talk about lifelong learning and active citizenship. So that community mentor program, what Ruth Ann was talking about, the Nicaragua trip, those are the things that sort of resonate with me that it's beyond just the you know, core curriculum. Talk about that. Are there more ideas about how to develop good citizens?
Getting out in the community, I think, is key, and I think what Ruth Ann does is awesome. I think making that available to all students is the challenge, and I'd love to make that available to all students to get them part of Hopkins, and it's a great community. It's a lovely place to be. It's very small, and it's very safe. And I think for students to get out in the world and just kind of get it, even in their own community, and see what's out there, I think is really important because it kind of expands their mind a little bit more. It's like, okay, Hopkins is not just the whole center of the universe. Mm-hmm. Getting out there and making connections is really what's key. And I think a lot of students become afraid, or they say they want to apply to these big schools, Boston University, Boston College, and maybe they don't make it there because it's so big and they weren't prepared for that. Mm-hmm. So I want to prepare them earlier and get them into the world earlier than later. Yeah. I don't know if that answers the question, but just kind of making...
A little bit to that, Paul, because I know you and I have talked about this when you first started on the school committee. I think there are some opportunities to thread the needle. Last year, Senora brought together a group of students, and it wasn't the first time that she had a conversation with students at Hopkins who had a real interest in having a formal service club. They wanted it to be their own service club. They weren't as interested in connecting to a Key Club or Kiwanis, not that those aren't great organizations, but they wanted their own service club. And there's a real desire for students to contribute locally in their communities here, whether it's if we think of ways to connect more with our senior center, with local needs in this community, with food pantries in this community. We certainly see students who are very interested in contributing nationally. Mr. Burns gets a lot of interest. The difficulty sometimes is there's going to be a cost associated with those particular trips, but there certainly is a great deal of interest in how young people can be civic-minded at the national level. And now, Senora has noticed that there is a tremendous interest in kind of how can we give globally. So it's something I was struck by when I came for my interviews here. I was struck by the community, and I was struck by the character of the student body, that collectively there were a group of young people who it was clear to me had a desire to make an impact on the world, to contribute something meaningful, and young people who understand that although they are, by and large, academically talented, I am always struck by, I say that intellectual people might be smart, and wise people are people who use their intellect in service to others. And I am continually struck by the fact that young people at the elementary, at Hopkins, have that desire. So we're looking at ways to, how do we thread the needle? We have these pockets of enthusiasm, students who want to do things locally, nationally, and globally. And over time, we're hoping to get better on really making that, because it's also in our district mission statement, a global citizen. What does that mean? How do we do it? And what are the corresponding opportunities we provide for young people so that they can achieve that?
And also, there are some initiatives underway, such as the really well-developed capstone project that's been led by Ms. Camuso and Ms. Freeland for the last several years, that I think every year gets better and better in terms of the platform of presentation to the community. So there's a whole bunch of different things that are going on and potentially available. And it will take a whole community to kind of tie those things together in a way that will make it efficient for the student to do something or multiple things that are really meaningful and pull it back to something that's worthwhile and culminating. And that's also a little bit measurable in terms of allowing them to see their own growth and for us to see that we've been successful as a school community in putting students out who have a broad range of skill sets instead of just being wicked smart, for lack of a better phrase. So.
And we also see this at the elementary school. Many of you that had children or still have children at the elementary school, there are all these pockets where the students get very enthusiastic about doing things for others, whether it's for a classmate or for a cause. And so it is clear to me that Hadley is a community that cares, and we're thinking very actively about what does that mean, how do we bring it to fruition, and how do we connect all those opportunities.
I think the data that you brought us on the post-secondary enrollment trends is really interesting, and you'd mentioned we may not have seen that before, and I think it's very positive data. Mm-hmm. One of the things that might be interesting to add to that too is, if one or two of our graduates go into the military, that also affects, your numbers. Mm-hmm. It would be very interesting to have that alongside the post-secondary enrollment, just to understand where the graduating class
is. It is available from each year.
Yeah.
For students in their exit polling, and from what we know from commitments, we tab at least on exit 100% of graduates in their plans. And if you go onto the Department of Education website, mm-hmm. under school profiles, that data is actually available there. The 2014 data is probably the most recent that's been uploaded to that point.
Great.
But that should go back for about a decade.
Thanks.
The Naviance PowerPoint said that it tracked kids going to college and then said it tracked graduation.
If you pay for that service, well, you don't have that service.
Okay. But it's tracking how our graduates do,
yes,
once they leave here?
Yes.
Wow.
So Edwin does the same thing.
So all the data you saw came from, this is public school profile data that Shugart or Hopkins Academy used, mm-hmm. That Brian was referring to, mm-hmm. accountability data?
Students. Dropout rate, graduation rate, plans.
Plans of high school graduates.
Plans of high school graduates, a little bit up, yep.
Thank you. So you can see up in the corner, you don't have 2015 data. They haven't uploaded because they'll take that from our October 1 count this year. So the other data came off Edwin Analytics, which also comes from the department.
Private, public, okay, mm-hmm. 2 year.
And the Edwin Analytics data, the charts that you saw came out of this place called Edwin Analytics. That's all post-secondary enrollment, as mm-hmm. I said, public or private. You can sort that for Mass public institutions. It will also tell you if the school committee is ever interested or the public is ever interested in learning more in the aggregate. Obviously, we'd never do individual student data, but in the aggregate, it will tell you completers. So what percentage of your students who started a four-year degree completed a four-year degree? Did they do that in 4 years or 5 years? How many persisted into year two? So sometimes that's interesting to find out. Great, everybody got into college, but to Ms. Collins' question or concern is, we may be preparing them well to get there, and how are they doing once they're there? I will tell you that Ms. Cullen and I looked at the Edwin data for persistence, and they do well in college too. They just do well here, period.
I'm really excited to see the community mentor piece, especially. The data really shows out there that when a student feels as though they have a mentor who really cares about their success, beyond their parents, mm-hmm. sometimes it's a teacher, oftentimes it's hard in a public school setting where the ratios are just not right, but that really helps with persistence and their positive outcomes. So I'm really excited to see that.
Good. I'm excited for it too. I have various ways I want it to go, so.
Awesome.
Great.
Thank you. I'm going to turn this off.
Thank you.
It was very good informative. The back and forth. Thank you.
You liked all that?
Yeah, that was awesome. Because it worked. It usually doesn't. Cole says hi.
Hi, Cole.
I sent your picture to him. All right. Gift account.
That can go under Chris's.
Oh, it can?
Okay, yep.
Okay. I assume we have no public comment period, taking a gaze out. District strategy, superintendent progress report.
Yes, so this is trying to do something different than just the written superintendent's report. So by design, unless of course the school committee indicated that you didn't want to see it, but I thought it might be helpful since it's only a single page to keep the district strategy in front of us all the time so we can monitor our progress and see if it still makes sense.
We worked so hard on it, of course we want to see it.
Yeah. Their packet, which normally... Like it.
It's lovely.
What I'll do for the public at our future meeting, since it's each of these is only one page, is to have the strategy document up so the public can see it. And then the report is the progress report, which is the next handout in your packet. Mm-hmm. And so what it has is on the first column, work to date, and that gives you examples of activities that we're doing, things that are underway in the district. So for example, at Hadley Elementary School. I've talked to you a little bit about this. The faculty met in August to design the MASS tiered systems of support model, which is a tiered academic intervention model. What that means is we're working very hard to address the academic needs of all of our students based on data. So we look at data, we look at their strengths, and where they might require additional support, particularly in literacy. And then we make sure we design instruction in very small groups so that we see the kinds of gains that we saw last year in grade one. If you recall, we did something similar in grade one as a pilot last year. And if you remember, I showed you the change in DIBELS, which is a diagnostic inventory of basic early literacy skills. That test data and in the aggregate how that went from a red-green combo, a nice kind of fall foliage look, to pure green. We went from fall to spring. It was very nice. So this year we're trying to expand that model through grades kindergarten through grade three. Staff met in August. They had two data days in September where they got together and looked at all of their formative literacy assessment data. And you see in the next column, alignment to strategic priorities, that goes right back to the district strategy document. So those letters B1, A2, so we said that we wanted to implement systems of support to meet the needs of all students. We wanted to measure the impact of instruction using assessments that are comparable across grades and subjects. We want to improve effectiveness of data teams through professional development and regular meetings. And we want to plan and facilitate staff-led meetings in which small groups of educators analyze data and solve instructional problems. So what I've done is taken something that the faculty is working on and shown you the district priorities to which I think that work aligns. And the next column shows you the alignment with the standards of effective practice that all educators are evaluated under, those standards of instructional leadership. Well, administrators, it's instructional leadership, management and operations, family, community engagement, and professional culture. And lastly...
But we prioritized mm-hmm. some aspects of each of those, correct?
Correct, mm-hmm. correct. District-wide, yes.
Okay.
And... Lastly, the assessment of impact. So what do we expect to happen, or how will you know if anything changed as a result of this activity of trying to implement a model of tiered instruction? And I'm saying that with Principal Udall, that we would review with the school committee student growth data and literacy. So you would all see aggregate student DIBELS data and the change in the aggregate performance, so no individual students would be identified from fall until the end of the school year, and what kind of growth that we see. Just a couple more activities. I won't take you all the way through, but that's just to kind of tell you how it's laid out. The goal is to try to develop a through line or a connection between the district strategy, what the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education calls the standards for effective practice upon which all educators are evaluated, and how we assess whether or not the work is making a difference. Some additional things. Chris and I submitted that budget document that was sent to you under separate cover, so you saw what the first two sections of a meritorious budget award look like. This year we'll add an additional section, either information or a finance section, and then ultimately you have four sections to get the full award, but we've submitted it to something called the Pathways Program,
So a group, it'll be peer-reviewed by business officials in Canada and the United States, and they will send the chair of the school committee notice that we're awarded that and feedback on the budget document. And Principal Udall held, another thing that's important is our facilitating parent information and feedback sessions in order to gather input on academic and behavioral supports and communication of student progress. So Mr. Udall held an information session on the new standards-based report cards. He didn't have any parents show up. He did hold that information session. A lot of parents, though, were able to get their questions answered at conferences because there were copies of the new report card template there, which I think is where most parents had all their questions answered. And Principal Beck held an information session on the parent portal at Open House in September and has subsequently had communications with parents about the parent portal. If you have questions about that, he can speak to that. I'll just say to the last one, so another thing that's important to us is fostering and building a professional culture by seeking staff input. So we develop goals and action plans with the district administration, and there was one example included in your packet of an action plan that kind of lays out how Mr. Udall intends to implement the mass tiered system of support at Hadley Elementary School. We've met with the Joint Labor Management Team this year and the Professional Development Committee, and we surveyed the staff on our first full Professional Development Day in October. And the staff survey data on the Professional Development Day indicated that the staff found the PD day to be effective. There were 8 session options staff could choose from. Of 4 of the sessions, 100% of the staff rated the sessions as effective, 1 session 95%, 1 session 83%. There was a session where only 70% of the staff thought it was effective, and a session where only 57% of the staff thought it was effective. But overall, there was a lot of positive feedback. Are there any questions on the document, on the work? Yeah?
So do you see this as a growing document month by month by month? This will just continue to grow and we will see all of the work through the course of the year?
So my plan was actually to try to keep it limited to, so I would bring you new activities until such time as I updated you on this. So for example, the mass teacher system of support, rather than keeping that on here next time, there may be other things that are underway, but certainly you'll see this again when we assess the impact, whether it's mid-year or the end of the year. But I can present it however you would like. So if you want to keep adding to the document, it's entirely... That was all about the one page thing.
I know you were. I can go either way. I kind of like the idea of just like every scene, adding a date column,
sure.
And then after assessment of impact, a column that says, what is the evaluation at the appropriate time? June, January, or whatever, so that we can see throughout the course of the year everything that's happening. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, we could just ask for something like this every month and we could collect them and see what's happening.
I think if we have them every month and we label these, you know, by month, then next month what we're going to see is more work to date on specific priorities, mm-hmm. that will be just not necessarily a complete continuation of this, but a different line item.
Right.
You know, like
right.
These may not change.
So you're saying
over time.
We'll put a date up here.
I can
yeah.
add a date.
But maybe we still want a column of like when it was introduced and when, so that we can see the sequentially, we're still working on this. Do you know what I mean?
Sure, I can try to put that in there.
Do you know what I'm trying to say?
I do, and I want you to know, so for example, the MTSS, that is not something I would put on there every month. So my thinking is telling you this is underway, and what you want to see next is what kinds of professional development activities are we providing for staff to build their capacity to analyze data and make instructional decisions, and then you want to see the student data, which won't be available
exactly. right.
either mid-year until the end of the year.
Right.
So I wouldn't just keep this on here, well, just know it's in place, and then when the student data is available, I would provide you with student data, or I would provide you with information on the kinds of professional development we've given to the faculty. And one of the reasons I also opted for this, I know last year we struggled a bit with some of the quantitative indicators,
right.
and I was at a conference with Ms. Camuso, I heard a great speaker it was a couple Saturdays ago, we went out to Cambridge, and I heard a great speaker from the Harvard School of Ed, and he said, don't let an approximate indicator of the goal, don't let the metric be confused for the goal. And that far too often, not that we don't want to, I certainly am very interested in showing you student data, very interested in showing you what's going on for our kids in post-secondary.
We're all cold.
But also keeping in mind that sometimes these things, I don't know, they'll take time. You'll see the student data over time. With the budget, I wouldn't report on that again, the previous budget document. We'll have another budget season underway until you'll get a letter from them saying either it was awarded or it was not, and here's why or why not, what needs to be improved in order to get the award.
I think, I mean, it's helpful as a snapshot because you can look down and see that, you know, A, B, C, and D are all represented, and you've got some very specific examples. And, I mean, having a monthly update to me on that would be very helpful.
Okay. And if there's ever anything that you're interested in or a particular indicator, as I said, it'll be my habit, and I'll show it to the community. I won't belabor this every month, but so the community, we can keep this in front of the community. What is it that we said we were trying to accomplish? And then I'm updating you on the kinds of things we're doing that I think are leading us toward those goals. And if the school committee believes that the activities don't align well, or you would like more information on something else, both documents will always be in the packet. And of course, all of our packets and minutes are posted to the district website, so anyone in the community can see them at any time.
Mm-hmm. And are you thinking this, instead of your superintendent report, this will be the new format?
That's what I was thinking.
Okay.
I thought it might be easier for the committee to simply track the work of the district.
Makes sense.
Does that make sense?
Yes, nice.
Okay, and I think if there weren't additional questions on that, I am finished. It is on to Chris, the man of the hour, the man with the money.
As of right
bring
now,
a suitcase of money.
Tom was looking at me with inquisitive eyes. Okay, so a couple of items. You have the first grant report of this year in your packages. Not really a lot of activity going on in those accounts yet because of the fact that some of them just came in. So, you know, we haven't had expenses go to them yet. The circuit breaker, obviously, is not really a grant. We just included with the grant grants in the report. That money starts coming in July, and we get it quarterly. So that amount gets spent quicker because we already have the money in. Some of these grants will have expenses that went to the regular school budget transferred to them this month. So you'll see the amount used go up considerably from what it is here. And the regular budget report, the amounts will go down. So, you know, it's not actually additional expenses, just a transfer of them to where they should be. And that's basically it with the grants. There's not a lot of excitement, I have to say, this month. If you thought the grants were boring, the regular budget is even less exciting than that, because...
That's okay. I don't know that we want like excitement unless it's like
money.
Basically, you see a couple of accounts with negative balance that we can transfer from other accounts to make up. One of the accounts with a negative balance will be transferred to the grant, so that'll bring it back to the positive. All of the other accounts at this point in time are really looking like we're just right on track. So, we can all be happy, I guess, with that. We do have some excitement, though, so we can move on to that.
Hey, Chris, just one thing on the page 8, the heating maintenance.
Yes.
Is that a particular issue that I'm just forgetting, the $9,500 for?
The heating in the, especially at Hopkins, is just really an old system. Typically, we run into problems throughout the year. We ran into them early this year. Okay. So as you can see, I think...
It's at 11,000.
Yeah. You can see we've already pretty much used up. Some of that encumbrance, the 9,500 encumbered, that is a purchase order that we put in with the vendors that we typically use throughout the year to do repairs. So it's not actually spent yet. It's just that this way Jeff can get the repair done and the money is already reserved for it rather than waiting until the purchase order is approved.
Okay.
Which would delay, just getting the repairs done.
Gotcha.
But yeah, the heating systems really, I mean, they're old.
Do we need to think about that more carefully, and as we think about our capital plan, be thinking about the age and expense of the Hopkins heating system? Because it feels like we're spending a lot of money every year.
We do spend a lot of money on repairs.
Taking care of our touchy heating system.
We put AC on the list, right?
we didn't put new furnaces.
Right.
Well, you know, that is a way, is you do those split things, and you can do both.
Right.
Yeah, that's something I can certainly speak with Jeff about, who deals with them a lot more than I do, obviously. So.
And it might be worth doing an analysis of how much are we spending on keeping those
babies purring. It's pretty steady with a pretty decent amount. So.
Yeah.
And we've done a lot of work. We've had a company that we hire annually now to just come in and go through the entire system over the summer. So, you know, that takes care of a lot of the potential problems before we actually need the heat, so that way we don't have cold classrooms in the winter. But again, it's just, you know, they fix one item and then, you know, eventually another item breaks, so that's kind of just how it goes. I mean, we're dealing with a heating system that's probably 40 or 50 years old, so. Mm-hmm. But fortunately, we have had a lot of work done on just tightening up the building, so we're actually using considerably less oil.
Yep.
And we had that whole system put in last year that kind of cuts down even more the amount of oil that we use. So at least we're getting the most out of the system we have, if nothing else. Any other questions on that? Okay. So we went out to bid again for the generator project. Last time we had 6 bids. This time we have 2. Fortunately for us, the amount actually came down by a couple thousand dollars. So I guess it was okay that we went out again. And we got a bid from USNE Inc. in Westfield and ML Schmidt Schmidt in Springfield. USNE's bid was $127,963 and ML Schmidt's was $138,500. We have about $134,000 to get the job done. So I went through the big bid documents with Jeff. Both of them submitted exactly what was necessary. They had all the necessary requirements to do the job. Schmidt typically does the work in the school district, but I mean, Schmidt went up, which we could not understand. They went up about $8,000 or $9,000 from bid 1 to bid 2. And USNE came down. Now the difference, we're talking about $10,500 difference. I cannot recommend going with Schmidt, really, when we have a much lower bid from USNE. That will actually allow us to possibly get some additional items hooked up to the generators, because we'll have about $7,000 to play with.
Nice.
So we can, we can certainly do that as well. So this does just require your approval of whichever vendor you prefer. As I said, I would recommend USNE.
I think you have to. Yeah. I think they're required under 30B to take the lowest responsive and responsible bidder. So is that USNE?
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, depends on how we wrote it. If you don't have to take the low bid, if you've written it that you don't have to take the low bid. But if you think the low bid is also good and qualified, then we should take the look.
We do, actually. I mean, they gave us recommendations. We checked their website. They do a lot of this, so it's not like, you know, it's a company that is just trying to get in or something.
So you need a vote from us?
We do, yes.
So what's the USNE?
USNE, yes.
Okay.
Move to accept the bid from USNE.
Second.
You can add.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you. I will let them
And do
know.
We need to, that we can just go ahead and get more things hooked up as part of that without changing?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, once you award a project to a vendor, you can then negotiate with the vendor to either reduce the price, reduce the scope, you know, really whatever we'd like to do, or in this case, possibly increase the scope.
And so, what's the anticipated timing?
Well, it's probably, I'm thinking, probably in the spring that it would be finished. I would recommend to them that they get right in here and do things like pour the pads outside, you know, while it's still warm enough to do that. Then a lot of it depends on the winter we have.
Right.
You know,
if we
get 6 feet of snow again or something, or however much we got, I don't think they'll be doing much work on it. But
Well, good job, Chris. That didn't take that long.
2 years. I will also just be, I need your approval on this one too. Mm-hmm. We would like to open a gift account for Hopkins Academy and Hadley Elementary, two separate accounts. We don't have gift accounts now, and it's really a good idea to have them in case somebody gives a donation. We will have a place to put it. We've had in the past items that have gone into the student activity account basically because there's no other place to put them.
Right.
It's not really the right way to do it, so opening up the gift accounts would certainly just, as I said, give us a place to put the donations.
That's a great idea. And is that for both Hopkins and Hadley Elementary?
We would open two separate ones.
Do we have to?
We don't. And if you prefer, we don't have to. It would just make tracking it, it's almost, just making it easier for the school principal to say, oh, that's my account, I know how much is in it, rather than, well, that's the public school's account, how much is mine? You know, that kind of thing. So that was the only reason I requested two, but if you prefer one.
Well, my only question is, couldn't there be a random gift that then how do you decide where it goes? That's what goes to you and Annie?
Oh, you mean if somebody just donated $10,000 to the schools or something, they would say, oh, how do we split that up?
Right.
You split it evenly. You can split it evenly. I
mean, so arm wrestle between the two principals?
I want to see
or
that.
Or depending
that
on what, the, what they're gifting it for?
Yeah, that was my only question.
Currently, where does something like Helping Hearts donation go?
Actually, that stays in the Helping Hearts account.
I think they just buy the stuff. And and trustees just buy, right?
Yeah. Helping Hearts, the invoice goes to the town hall and right out of that account there.
So
it's a little bit different because they don't actually give the money to the schools. They give it to the town hall. That actually works quite well.
Got it.
Who has then discretion to spend that money?
Typically, a gift is designated for a particular purpose. And so, just say, for example, somebody gave $1,000 to buy a computer or something for Hadley Elementary, then obviously Mike Duffy would be the one to order the computer. It's very seldom that you see a gift just donated to the school and do whatever you would like with it. If that were the case, that would really be up to the school committee to determine how the funds would go.
So if there was one account, it would be under the superintendent's purview? To decide where it, if it wasn't encumbered towards a certain thing, ultimately it would be the superintendent's responsibility?
Well, the superintendent could certainly make recommendations. You would approve it.
Right.
The school committee would approve the spending of it. But yeah, the superintendent could say, hey, we have X amount of dollars sitting in this account that are not earmarked for anything. I would like to propose we use it for this, and then you could go wrong.
Are those donations tax deductible?
I don't believe they are. Although schools are not a for-profit organization, I don't believe they're actually a 501c3 organization.
That's
therefore,
right.
That's
why we couldn't get the
Subaru.
Thank you. Right.
Right. That's why it comes in through Helping Hearts or a PTO.
And to be honest, even Subaru was pretty strict about wanting to have a 501c3, but if they were not, we had no place to put the money.
Right.
That's what having the gift account will actually do, is at least we have some place to deposit the money.
And a gift account would operate like other revolving accounts in terms of it's not money that has to be turned back over.
Right, it could be carried over year to year.
Right.
Yep.
Without formal action, it just occurs.
Yes.
Makes sense. I like the idea of a unified account, just for the sake of, purview being in one place and, donations being managed together. But I could be open to two accounts.
I'm actually thinking the opposite. The two accounts would be more helpful for tracking in case somebody does actually designate, I really want this to be for Hopkins Academy. I don't know whether we would have those kinds of donations, but I don't know. I could see somebody who's a graduate of Hopkins and never was part of the elementary school might make a donation with that kind of restriction.
And because of that, because like the Hopkins school benefits greatly from the trustees and money is only channeled to Hopkins, I see it as sort of almost not divisive, but it doesn't help the whole system necessarily. Mm-hmm. So I wonder whether purview under a united sort of a person who's responsible for the whole vision of the district makes sense.
We could give authority to open the gift account or accounts and let Chris Stu on the issue of which is better.
You know, I mean, there really is, there's no better way, in all honesty. Actually, I spoke with my boss about this tonight before the meeting, and he said some towns have one account, some towns have one for each school, and it really just depends on what the committee wants. And really, you know, he said the same thing about at least the principals would know how much is in their school account. But we can always report that anyway, you know. I mean, if we needed to, we could just say X amount is earmarked for this. And, you know, we could do something like that as well. So
could we? So since it would be a revolving account, then technically they would see it on the revolving accounts report like they see all other revolving accounts. And if there were one account, would it be possible then to identify HA designated, HES designated, undesignated?
Sure.
So you could have one account, and then typically you have a revolving accounts report. You don't have it now because we're still working out some of the things with the revolving accounts. You'll have it, you typically have it monthly, and it shows you the balances on all revolving accounts. So this could be an account that we would just apprise you of the balances of, and then we could indicate, as I said, by school what's designated and what amount is undesignated.
That makes sense.
Great.
All right, so we're saying,
I just created about 50,000 journal entries for you. You can thank me later.
Yeah.
Move to open a gift account.
Subcodes?
One with three divisions. Okay, yes. Motion? You just made it?
Just made it.
Okay, second?
I'll second it.
All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. And just an update, really, I'm working with the town accountant to just rename the grant accounts at the town hall. The account names there are so old, they just have really no resemblance to the actual grants now. And what happens is, you know, we changed the names of our accounts here a couple of years ago so that it would say something like, you know, 240 SPED grant would be one of, you know, the account names. The grant code is 240, so anytime a payment would come in, it would have that code on it, we know immediately where to put the money. But the town hall accounts do not have the code on it, and it has some wacky name that really has no resemblance to what the grant actually is. So it's just been a nightmare to try to get the money put into the proper accounts at the town hall. And now we have a new town treasurer and a new town accountant, and I got a couple of emails from the treasurer saying, you got some grant money in. Here's my guess at where they go, because, you know, again, she can't possibly know where this goes. And so I met with the accountant and explained, you know, our dilemma and suggested that we change the names of the accounts, and he agreed to do that. So they're going to be working on that at the town hall, and that'll just really make life so much easier for everyone, I think, in the end. Great. So just a quick update, that's all.
And the new town accountant is a company that's serving several towns, right?
I believe so, yes.
Do you know if they are working in any towns that have single school districts, so that they have?
I don't
them?
Know what other towns they do, quite honestly.
They have two in Franklin County, but both are regional school districts, so they wouldn't be at that similar.
Yeah, I don't know.
Okay. And I don't know that we've ever had a presentation of the meritorious budget and what it all means. That might be that was for the public as well. Maybe that's okay. A future meeting if people are interested.
Sounds great.
Yep.
I don't know who that goes to. That goes to the two
Us.
Of you.
Yeah. Yes. Yes. Probably a good time would be when we get the feedback, which they told us 4 months, and maybe sooner than that. So, and perhaps in our presentation this year, we can be a little more explicit about what parts, even doing FY17. So we should have about the time that we're really gearing up for FY17, we'll have the feedback from FY16's document. So does that make sense when we get feedback from them?
Yeah.
Then we can share with the community if we got it, which would be a huge win. There are very few, just, you know, very, very few districts in the Commonwealth that pursue this or have been awarded it. There are, I don't know, there are probably fewer than 10. Maybe a little bit more than that, but I don't think so. There are few in Massachusetts. So when we get that feedback, as we go through the feedback, that's a way to kind of let people know what's expected. And it's the purpose is to create a budget document that provides
is a communication tool for the community. So you find that there's a tremendous amount of information. It takes a while to load. If anyone from the public is trying to go on our website and load it, it takes a few seconds because it's a large document. But you find all the relevant school committee fiscal policies. You find graphs on enrollment data. You find information about the town's tax rate. All kinds of information, all in one place, as well as a district strategy and how we tie our resource allocation to the goals that we're trying to achieve.
And the only other thing is that Annie told me today that the town is already itching for FY17 budget numbers, so that I will talk to the chair of the select board about that and see what their time, what their hoped for timing is, but.
Last year, I believe they wanted things by 12/31.
Yeah.
And again, I mean, we can
and
give them something, but it's
then.
That's just very early.
Right. So I'll report back after I've talked.
Okay.
We're on to school committee reports. Starting with the policy subcommittee, we are in second reading for the Title I supplement, not supplant, policy and procedures, which is quite a name. Are there any questions on that? If not, we can move right to an acceptance of those changes. And the changes, Pat, are both mostly on the last page, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. Questions, concerns, or a motion?
I move to accept that document with a long
supplement,
title.
Supplement, not supplant.
Thank you.
Second, anyone?
I'll second it.
Okay. Questions, comments, all in favor?
Aye.
Excellent.
Thank you. Thank you.
And then we have changes to the elementary handbook, the Hopkins Academy handbook, and to one other document.
District curriculum.
Yes. The district curriculum. Thank you. And all of these are based on
recommendations from the coordinated program review. So we're required to make these changes. That was part of our corrective action plan. Attorney Adam Dupre, Fred's son, reviewed the requirements from the corrective action plan. He then put together the changes that you see here, and what we did for you in the documents in your packet are the summary of changes. And then we didn't take the entire, if the committee is interested, I did bring the entire documents with all of the track changes, but as you can imagine, the table of contents gets changed, everything gets changed, so I did not put that in your packet. Instead, we summarized the changes, we put the text in here that would be added, and these are all exactly as they were written by Attorney Dupre.
And you and Pat have reviewed what he did, and you're happy with all of the changes and agree that it follows the report?
Yep.
So we could call that first reading and come back in November to approve. Okie doke.
Yeah,
sounds good.
Sounds great.
And unless this
That may be, actually. I just wanted to bring the school committee up to speed, but I just want to make sure that I understand that. Does that apply to the district curriculum accommodation plan, too, first reading and then second? So I had them out. Yes.
I think so. All three, right?
Yeah.
The two handbooks and the plan.
Yep. And I think that's all I have for policy tonight, mm-hmm. right?
Yes. Although,
except
so this question, yes. So we have part of when the technology committee got together to review Judy Bohall's recommendations for the library, and she also brought some of those recommendations before you all, the long-term
yep.
plan.
Mm-hmm.
You approved
yep.
that plan. One of the things that the students indicated when they were surveyed is they'd like the library to be open at lunchtime, but that creates a bit of a staffing supervision problem. So we reached out to parents in the community who are willing to volunteer. The library is a high traffic area. The principal's in and out, teachers are in and out making copies. My inclination was to have them, parents, queried like we do volunteers at the elementary school. I was not planning on requiring all those parent volunteers to be fingerprinted. Does somebody have any concerns about the logic with that?
I think that sounds logic.
That's similar to what we do with athletics, right? They're just
yeah.
quarried, not fingerprinted.
Do
Do you need a motion? No, I just wanted to make sure. I wanted to make sure that I made my thinking transparent and that you knew. So our parent volunteers in Hopkins Library, and we are very grateful for those parents who have offered to volunteer and make it so the library can be open for our student, would be Corey checked. All adults would be Corey checked, but they will not have to go to that seedy place and pay money to have their fingerprints here. But if at some point you're a parent who's required to do that, it's really not that bad.
Unless you have to go back three times like I did, because apparently I wash my hands too much.
And thank you
and
to
no
all
longer
the,
have fingerprints.
All the parents who are going to volunteer to keep the library open. What a great, important asset and resource.
Yes. We're very grateful.
Roby's not here. Do you know if there is any CES update?
I don't.
Okay, so we'll put that off until November and assume all is well there. Heather, Unit D.
Discussions are ongoing. We have tentative agreements on a number of areas. We have two more meetings scheduled with them.
Do we?
We had one for tomorrow that has been canceled.
And so
we had two more on the
calendar. Oh, really? Oh, good.
Because we go into December. Okay. But it's moving forward, making progress.
Great. And Paul, Building and Grounds, please.
Building and Grounds, we had a meeting that was open to the public on the 13th. Roby and I were there. We had two members of the public as well, and we talked about the athletic fields. Exclusively and talked about how to phase the development of the fields and what would a phase one look like. We have the building design specs, really trying to break it down into what are the real actual 2015 costs, what does it really have to do. So there were some tasks stemming from that. We were going to go to some members of the public who expressed interest in volunteering and frankly know a lot about building grounds. For example, Dan Murkowski works at UMass, and so he and I had a phone call, and he's gathering more information. I'm going to reconnect with him this week. Jim Mahalik was there. He's going to talk to Jeff Misch about the irrigation system. I talked to him this morning. He's following up on that. So still more conversations to be had, but our goal is to figure out how we can break down what was originally a $1.3 million estimate into smaller chunks, and what would a phase one. So we talked a bit about what should a phase one entail. And now we're really trying to get a true cost estimate of that. So once we do, obviously, we'll bring it back to this committee.
Perfect.
Great.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Did we do all of, are we done?
We
do all of our action items?
I think so. Let's check. Yes, because the other changes are first reading and they'll come back. Oh, I'm sorry, no. Ms. Bohol, and I did not, originally I was going to include the list, and it just seemed kind of crazy. So the Judy Bohol, our media specialist and librarian at Hopkins Academy, has requested that the school committee designate her recommended materials as surplus. The basis for the recommendation has to do with the age of the books, the frequency with which they're checked out. So there are several pages, but on some of these pages you see last use none, because the last time they were checked out was so long ago that they just aren't being used. And the books are very old. Judy has identified a place called Better World or Better Books where she can actually donate. There's a place in Chicopee, so we don't have to throw all these books in a landfill. We can actually donate them and the books will be used or repurposed or recycled. But because it's surplus, it requires a vote by the school committee, if you'd like to follow Ms. Bohol's recommendation, to designate the materials as surplus.
Please designate the old books as surplus and recycle them to Chicopee rather than the landfill.
Yeah.
Is that a motion?
Motion. I'm taking that as a motion.
Please. Okay. Motion.
There's no book banning effort in there? Subterfuge?
No, not that I know. No. I don't think there's any book canning.
It's not all Huck Finn.
No. Picasso for Children is going to go. That's unfortunate, but it hasn't been checked out.
Seconded.
Thank you.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Okay. So
what about the approval of Nature's Classroom? I don't recall that.
That was put off until November.
Oh, okay, got it.
What is our plan for, do we build into the budget? God, I should know this. How long have I been on this committee? How do we, when we dispose of pages and pages and pages of books, how do we replace them?
Sometimes we don't. You know, I mean, for example, if you've got numerous volumes on that list that the last use was none, there's really no, you know, no reason to replace some of them. We're replacing, well, I'm not really sure what Judy's plans are as far as replacement, but we have still the insurance money left.
Oh, good.
From the, steam pipe bursting. So some kind of materials will be replaced with that. Mm-hmm. And
in addition to that, Judy put through a Helping Hearts request, which we will be presenting to the school committee, Helping Hearts, either in November or December. We met Brian, Jeff, and I met with Stacy Mushinsky to go through all the requests from the faculty. We identified the vast majority of them could be funded either through Helping Hearts or through some grant funds, and Judy requested several nooks, and Helping Hearts approved that. So I also know, in addition to the library, the replacement funds for insurance, she's purchasing a number of nooks for the library. That was something that students identified on the survey that they'd like to see.
So then the school could purchase digital copies of the book, and then students can take that out.
And they can check out the nook, correct.
Wonderful.
Speaking of books, we need to report on our reading.
Yes, just on that. So if they get a nook, they could check out books from public library, right? Mm-hmm. And so it expands their book opportunities. Mm-hmm. It's pretty cool.
Why nook instead of Kindle?
Judy explained that to me, and I don't know if you were there, and if you were there, Chris, I'm hoping you remember, so I don't know if you were there.
I'm sure there's a logic to it.
There is a logic to it.
Is it related to the Bookshare, also the subscription we have for her to get free downloads?
Maybe a Nook thing?
Yeah.
And also, I think it had to do with maintenance and a tremendous cost break. Barnes & Noble has been very supportive. They're a local business here, and they have some tremendous bargains on the Nooks. So I think we got a very good cost break, and our contact over there has been very supportive and helpful to the school.
Nice.
So I don't know much about the plans and how these things are done, but I wonder if there's incentive for students to purchase a book that they're interested in for school through the school and through the library rather than independently. Like, I'm buying books for my kids all the time for a project they might be interested in. Is there an incentive that would enable me to give the money to Judy to buy it it stays within circulation here?
Or to donate the books after. I don't know if we have any kind of ability to do that.
Well, now that you have a gift account, you could certainly say and designate it for such a purpose. Right. Although I would want to ask Judy, because in terms of just what she's looking for in the collection.
That would be good.
I'm sure she'd be extraordinarily grateful, and I'd also want to make sure she has limited space, so where she's going with the collection.
Well, by way of the Nook, especially.
Yep.
Right?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Well, a lot of those subscriptions, you can share a book that you have purchased electronic version of, and you can share it with one or two other people.
Right.
You just need an email address, so that, that is a possibility.
That would be a great program to put in effect to make a book purchase more widely accessible.
Yeah.
We do have to report our reading, right? How are we doing that?
I don't really know.
It's
we should probably try to do it monthly, and we'll try to track it, but we haven't done it. So when did we start this? September 1st, basically?
It's title and number of pages, right? Because it's about number of pages.
I submit number of pages every week.
Not that's titles, it? Just number of pages?
Yeah. Just total pages.
I want to know what you're reading.
We're not. It's policy documents that come from the school committee.
Wow, that's fascinating stuff. You're lucky.
It is. Yeah. I am the most boring person on the planet.
So, number of pages, do you know? From September 1st, have you been keeping track?
Yeah,
I'm on my third book, maybe, I guess. I could probably estimate at this moment.
Probably too.
Okay.
Send it to you.
So I'll send it to you, Linda?
Yes, please. Okay. If you could send me September 1st through October 31st, and then I'll remind you every month.
Perfect.
Wow.
All right. Or I'll try to remind you every month. What's the chances I'll actually...
Yeah.
And when is our next meeting?
November 23rd.
Tomorrow.
Oh, there's executive session tomorrow. But then our regular meeting date is November 23rd.
Okay. And then December, do we?
We change that to December 28th.
First?
Yeah.
We did?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, when's the next one?
November 23rd. And we changed, and the time?
5:30 unless we need.
Unless we need executive session.
Okay. So we changed December to?
The 21st.
The 21st.
Okay.
That's great.
What was?
In terms of evaluation of the meeting, I love the new format of your presentation. I find it very helpful. Anyone else?
I really like that piece as well.
Yeah.
And I do like the one-page concept.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's good to, I mean, we talk about strategic objectives and priorities, and it's great to kind of recenter us on those every month. That's why we spent so much time pulling them together. We want to know how they're doing throughout the year, so I like it too.
And I forgot to say, I have no idea when the next tri-board meeting. Oh, maybe Richard knows when the next tri-board meeting is.
Wednesday night.
It's a tri-board?
Wednesday night.
5 to 6.
Oh, people.
Party down.
We'll be in touch with you to see if anyone can go to that. And where's our meeting tomorrow?
At the elementary school still. It's starting at 5 o'clock. We originally had executive session posted at 3. Now executive session will start at 5. Of course, we always have to adjourn an open session, but then it immediately will go into executive session.
And do we know where?
Hadley Elementary School, the conference room, I believe.
Okay.
Do we have any sense of how long?
An hour or less.
It's my birthday.
It is.
So that's, you get to me as a meeting.
We should sing
it's
at
a
least.
Lovely meeting. Yes.
Should we sing in open session?
Yes, exactly. Right.
That's right.
All right, motion to adjourn. Thank you all.
Hey.
Well, you.
Thank you. I was really good to accept it.